But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why, 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win.
Of course I know who I am. I'm an astronaut.
We want to understand what's going on in space today and what's happening with the plan to put weapons in space. I think it's instructive to go back and understand the origins of the U.S. space program. And to do that, you have to go back to Nazi Germany. Hitler recruited a brilliant young rocket scientist by the name of Wernher von Braun, who had a weekend rocket club, to come to work for the Nazis to build the V-1 and V-2 rockets that were used to terrorize the cities of London and Paris and Brussels towards the end of World War II. And for von Braun and his team, they set up along the Baltic Sea a place called Peenemünde. It was a research and development center for the Nazi rocket operation. And to this place at Peenemünde, the Nazis brought thousands of Jews and French resistance fighters to serve as prisoners, essentially slaves, to build this production effort. Well, the British found out about it, went in and bombed the entire operation. And so the Nazis said, we've got to move to a more secure location. And down inside of central Germany, there's a mountain chain called the Harz Mountains. And in that mountain, there's a huge tunnel where the Nazis were storing military hardware. Well, they cleared the whole thing out, moved the entire rocket operation into the tunnel, named it Mittelwerk. And just outside the mountain tunnel at Mittelwerk, the Nazis built a brand new concentration camp called Dora. And to Dora, the Nazis brought 40,000 Jews, gypsies, French resistance fighters, homosexuals, communists, even a black American GI were brought there to serve as slaves for the operation. Well, you know, immediately after the war, the U.S. and the Allies created the Nuremberg Trials, at which time we brought the Nazis to justice for their crimes against humanity. But 1,000 never went to trial. They were smuggled into the United States by the U.S. military under a program called Operation Paperclip, smuggled in through Boston and West Palm Beach, Florida. And Wernher von Braun and his rocket team, 100 of them, along with 100 copies of the V-2 rocket, were sent to Huntsville, Alabama, where von Braun became the first director of NASA's Marshall Space Flight Center. What's interesting is the other 1,400 Nazis. Who were they? Well, some of them were brought to the United States to work for the CIA. Others were brought to the United States to do the LSD drug experiments and the MK Ultra mind experiments during the 1960s, where people were jumping out of windows. Some of the Nazi scientists that in Germany had been taking Jews and putting them in freezing temperatures to see how the body would react to that were sent to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Ohio and were put in charge of the U.S. military flight medicine program. And so when you take 1,500 of the top Nazi scientists and essentially seed the military-industrial complex, the question I have is, do they bring with them an ideological contamination? Well, not only did von Braun go to work for NASA, but the guy that was in charge of the V-2 flight test program up at Peenemünde along the Baltic Sea, a guy by the name of Kurt Vibes, became the first director of the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. And then the man that recruited von Braun, Major General Walter Dornberger, the guy that was sent by Hitler to recruit von Braun to come to work for the Nazis, he became vice president of Bell Aerosystems Corporation in New York that made its riches building the helicopters for the war in Vietnam. In fact, in 1958, Dornberger testified before the United States Congress saying that America's top space priority should be to, quote, conquer, occupy, keep, and utilize space between the Earth and the Moon. And in fact, later on, in a speech before a National Missile Industry Conference, Dornberger told the assembled, gentlemen, I didn't come to this country to lose the Third World War. I lost two already. And then finally, the man that was in charge of production and middle work inside the mountain tunnel there in Germany, Arthur Rudolph. He became the first project director of the NASA Saturn V rocket program that took the United States to the moon. And so these are the essential origins of the U.S. space program. And the Space Command put out a planning document a few years ago called Vision for 2020. And on the cover of it, you see a satellite hitting targets on the Earth below. Let's take a look at some of the language in this so-called vision for 2020. The Space Command says that in the future, because of corporate globalization of the world economy, they expect that there's going to be a widening gap between the haves and the have-nots, between the rich and the poor all over the world. And as a result of that, the Pentagon predicts that there's going to be more and more regional instability around the world, because people that are under the boot of these multinational corporations are going to organize. They're going to try to organize unions. They're going to organize to get these corporations from controlling their governments. And the Pentagon says, you know, we can't put a Marine on every single street corner of the world to suppress these populations. But with space technology in place, we'll be able to see everything, hear everything, and essentially target everything in every place on the Earth. And the Vision 2020 says that space superiority will emerge as an essential element of battlefield success in future warfare.
Astronauts moving in slow motion is another hallmark of the Apollo TV footage. There is no evidence at all of any astronaut making a leap or a jump anywhere near a height commensurate with 1/6 G possibilities. But if they were actually simulating EVAs on Earth, they would then need help with their bulky heavyweight suits and backpacks in order to achieve the visual effect of moving around easily in lunar gravity. So enter wire supports. This is a tried and tested way of relieving weight from performers or even flying an actor. Here is a sequence from one of our own productions.
Excuse me, will I need a car?
Relax, Chris. We're only making a short journey back to 1969, to the beginning of humans.
Of course, confirmation that wires were used is in the detail. Here in this Apollo 14 footage, you can see a ping, a momentary glint. And again, run slowly. And once more. There are other examples too. This one is from Apollo 17 during the flag scene. You can see the ping at the top of the frame. In this footage from Apollo 16, we have telltale evidence for slightly floating or dangling effect at the jump salute location. It's as if the weight is being taken off the astronaut's feet just a second or so too soon. Compare that sequence with an obvious rehearsal rig. The dangling effect is very evident. And here again, from the same mission, Apollo 16, we have an astronaut who is about to get up.
Okay, here we go.
Let me give you a hand, he says.
There goes the bag. There goes another bag. Bag. Coming.
Look at it again. The astronaut is getting up with a wire taking the weight, relieving him of 5/6 of the Earth's gravity. A magic trick? No. Just the help of a wire man. This is a slow-motion jump that would have been seen live on TV. And here it is at normal speed. The well-rehearsed, pre-recorded material was apparently slowed down by 50% when we saw it on TV. And yes, we've done the necessary work to establish that percentage.
I'm William Cooper. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And we're going to talk about documents that I saw while I was with the Office of Naval Intelligence, specifically on the intelligence briefing team of the United States Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet, who at that time was Admiral Bernard Clary. These documents outlined the coming formation of a one-world socialist government, which as one body make up the mystery schools, or the ancient mystery religion of Babylon. This plan called for the creation of an external, artificial, and I stress that word artificial, threat to this Earth. The entire ufology movement, ladies and gentlemen, is a creation meant to bring that about. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, there is a plan to bring about a new world order, and a lot of the things that you see happening in the world today are a direct result of action taken to complete that plan. Now, many of you aren't going to believe a word that I'm saying, and that's okay. You will find out eventually, I can assure you. I talked yesterday about the creation of an artificial alien threat to this Earth to facilitate the destruction of sovereign nations, the coming together as one humanity under a one-world government, with all people willing to make whatever sacrifices are called upon them to make, such as giving up all your liberties and freedoms, and anything else they may ask you to do, in order to oppose this external threat. In order to make interstellar travel believable, which nobody was buying, nobody understanding the vast distances in space could even remotely conceive that somebody from some other star could make the journey from their planet to here. Not only that, but nobody could understand how they could find this planet or even want to come here given the billions and billions of choices that there are in the universe. So in order to make this believable, which absolutely had to occur for this scam to be swallowed by the people of the world, NASA, the National Aeronautic and Space Administration, was created. The Apollo space program, ladies and gentlemen, foisted the idea that man could travel to and walk upon the moon. Every single Apollo mission was carefully rehearsed and then filmed in large sound stages at the Atomic Energy Commission's top secret test site in the Nevada desert and in a secured and guarded sound stage at the Walt Disney Studios, within which was a huge scale mock-up of the moon. All the names, missions, landing sites, and events in the Apollo space program echoed the occult metaphors, rituals, and symbology of the Illuminati's secret religion. One of the most transparent, not the most, but one of the most transparent, was the faked explosion on Apollo 13, which was the metaphor for the initiation ceremony involving the death, which was the explosion, placement in the coffin, which was the period of uncertainty of their survival, communion with the spiritual world in the imparting of esoteric knowledge to the candidate, which was the orbit and observation of the moon without physical contact, rebirth of the initiate, which was the solution of the problem and repairs, and the raising up by the grip of the lion's paw, which was the reentry and recovery of Apollo 13. 13, ladies and gentlemen, is no coincidence. It is the number of death and rebirth, death and reincarnation, sacrifice, the phoenix, the Christ, but not the Christ that you know if you are a Christian, and the transition from the old to the new.
15, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, go for main engine start, main engine start, 2, 1, booster ignition, and liftoff of the Space Shuttle Discovery, returning to the space station, paving the way for future missions beyond.
Another revelation to those who understand the symbolic language of the Illuminati is the hidden meaning of the names of the space shuttles. Listen to this very carefully. I assume that you all know the names of the space shuttles. If you don't, they are all included in this sentence. Quote, a Columbian enterprise to endeavor for the discovery of Atlantis, and all challengers shall be destroyed, end quote. Exploration of the moon, ladies and gentlemen, stopped because it was impossible to continue the hoax without being ultimately discovered. They were pressing their luck as it was. And of course, they ran out of pre-filmed episodes. No man Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me very carefully. No man has ever ascended higher than 300 miles, if indeed any have ever ascended that high above the Earth's surface. No man has ever orbited, landed on, or walked upon the moon in any publicly known space program. If man has exceeded the 300-mile limit, and if man has ever truly been to the moon, it has been done in secret and with a far different technology. It was not done in the Apollo space program. And any high school student with a basic physics book can prove it.
I couldn't help at one point in our discussions with privately with General Secretary Gorbachev, when you stop to think that we're all God's children wherever we may live in the world, I couldn't help but say to him, just think how easy his task and mine might be in these meetings that we held if suddenly there was a threat to this world from some other species, from another planet outside in the universe. We'd forget all the little local differences that we have between our countries, and we would find out once and for all that we really are all human beings here on this earth together. Well, I don't suppose we can wait for some alien race to come down and threaten us, but I think that between us we can bring about that realization. Thank you all. God bless you all.
Thank you. Norrises are experts in non-lethal weapons technology. They are consultants to the Defense Department, CIA, NSA, and world-renowned think tanks.
The technology necessary to project three-dimensional images to a point in space requires no new breakthroughs in science. We have the technology now.
Overall, the non-lethal weapons development program is aimed at giving our military options between talking and shooting.
A specific system development we really can't talk about.
But the Morrises did talk in general about secret military experiments with lifelike 3D projections in the sky called holograms.
Holograms on a battlefield would be to divert the attention of the enemy to deliver propaganda or something very frightening to make the enemy run away if you think that he will believe that what you are sending is really an angel, a devil, a UFO.
And where could this type of weaponry be tested? Perhaps not coincidentally, along the U.S.-Mexico border at the Army's Electronic Proving Ground in Fort Huachuca, Arizona.
Keep in mind that test facilities like Fort Huachuca in Arizona are electrical optical test beds, and part of what they're testing are the effects of these electro-optical devices on a target population.
And the target population may be us.
America has to test American equipment in America.
Thank you. There are literally dozens of patents dealing with ways of beaming sonic transmissions directly into people's minds. This was once called telepathy. Today it's just modern day technology and advertising. Yes, I understand this sounds absolutely bizarre. Where's the proof? Where is it? We've recently seen Al Gore and Prince Charles appear in holographic form. But do we actually know of any such encounter we can attribute holographic technology as to having been used as part of a supernatural psyop? I believe we do. It's just a matter of looking at information. ABC News by ex-CIA spy John Curative. The topic was waterboarding. Curative came out in an un-CIA-like fashion and proclaimed that waterboarding is torture. On the ABC News website, in an article entitled "Coming in from the Cold, CIA Spy Calls Waterboarding Necessary But Torture," the ex-spy described the effectiveness of waterboarding on captured Al-Qaeda member Abu Zubaydah, and I quote, "John Kiridou, now retired, said the technique broke Zubaydah in less than 35 seconds. The next day, he told his interrogator that Allah had visited him in his cell during the night and told him to cooperate. Now, hold it for just 1 second. We believe this man is telling us the truth because he's playing nice and claiming that waterboarding is a bad thing. But look at what he just said. He's implying that when someone is tortured, they just have to say uncle, and then we stop. You would think that if Zubaydah was cracked in 35 seconds, that would mean he was spilling the beans only seconds after that. As in, okay, okay, fine, I'll talk, please, no more, no more. Not, oh my goodness, I'm glad you stopped. I didn't like that very much. I guess I'll go get some sleep, and I'll think about maybe telling you something tomorrow." And if we are to believe that it was indeed the waterboarding that broke him, then why would he bother telling his interpreter that Allah had visited him in his cell during the night and told him to cooperate? His interrogator knew he was waterboarded. He wasn't going to save any face with his interrogator. Remember, they broke him the day before, and they didn't get any information out of a quote-unquote broken man until the next day, after he claimed Allah came to him in his cell and told him to cooperate. I'm not making this up. Watch for yourself. Pay attention to the body language. You decide for yourself if this makes any logical sense.
And that was one of the techniques.
Waterboarding was one of the techniques, yes.
And was it used on Zubaydah?
It was.
And was it successful?
It was.
What happened as a result of that?
He resisted. He was able to withstand the waterboarding for quite some time, and by that I mean probably 30, 35 seconds.
That's quite some time.
Which was quite some time. And a short time afterwards, in the next day or so, he told his interrogator that Allah had visited him in his cell during the night and told him to cooperate because his cooperation would make it easier on the other brothers who had been captured. And from that day on, he answered every question just like I'm sitting here speaking to you.
In a willing way?
In a willing way.
Certainly we can talk. It's a rather primitive accomplishment. We use it when we must.
When we pray.
When we sing to our God.
Try to understand. The only weapons we have are purely illusion.
You just imagine that he hurt you. Traumatic hypnosis is a weapon of peace.
Like the visual deterrent. Or the sonic deterrent. Let me make a last appeal to your reason before we inflict more of this on you. These are weapons of peace, Mr. Brent.
Like all our weapons.
Mere illusions.
Illusions. Damn your hypocrisy! Is that bomb out there, is that an illusion?
Remember, I talked yesterday about the creation of an artificial alien threat to this earth to facilitate the destruction of sovereign nations, the coming together as one humanity under a one world government, with all people willing to make whatever sacrifices are called upon them to make, such as giving up all your liberties and freedoms than anything else they may ask you to do, in order to oppose this external threat. In order to make interstellar travel believable, which nobody was buying, nobody understanding the vast distances in space could even remotely conceive that somebody from some other star could make the journey from their planet to here. Not only that, but nobody could understand how they could find this planet or even want to come here given the billions and billions of choices that there are in the universe. So in order to make this believable, which absolutely had to occur for this scam to be swallowed by the people of the world, NASA, the National Aeronautic and Space Administration, was created.